Here we are this morning on a beautiful spring day in False Bay, and I want to take a look at a couple of colonial organisms that live here. So these are the relatives of the corals and the sea anemones and the zoanthids, which we've dealt with in other episodes. But these are animals with tiny little polyps, like little tiny sea anemones, grouped together to form a large colony. And there are three main groups within that. They're sea fans, sea pens, and soft corals. Those sea pens are an interesting group of colonial organisms that live on sand, so you don't often see them unless you're snorkeling over sandy areas. So the bottom of the animal is stuck into the sand and it sticks up just like a flight feather into the water. And the side branches of the flight feather each have little polyps on it. They're all genetically identical to one another. Often my students say to me, well, if it looks like a feather, why do we call it a sea pen and not a sea feather? And of course, the reason for that is that when these words were originally derived, then pens were feathers. So, and then you had your pen knife in your pocket to sharpen the feather and use it for writing. So if we were to name them today, we would probably call them sea feathers, but they're called sea pens. You don't often see the animals, the live animals, but you do often see the little pens washed up on the beach after storms.
And now they're just catching little particles in the waves.
Yes, so they're filter feeders. They stand against the current so that the current flows through the side branches of the feather, and then they're collecting little organisms and little food particles out of the water.
And would there usually be a few of them, or
they're often actually
like
whole
beds
of them?
Yeah.
So between like the city of Cape Town and Robben Island, for example, there are huge beds of them on the bottom, and if you dive there you can see hundreds and hundreds of them, and a lot of them get washed up there. So those are sea pens. Then sea fans, as the name suggests, form a flat structure made out of horn-like material, which is quite bendy, and you can use it to fan yourself if you want to. And along these fan-like branches are hundreds of little polyps, like little sea anemones, and they reach out into the water and grasp food particles and then share it among themselves. So it's all one colony, many different polyps, but they share food amongst one another. And they grow very large, so this is about the normal size that you would find, but I've just picked up a piece on the shore at my feet here, which is from an enormous colony. So some of these colonies grow to 1 or 2 meters tall, but you'll only see that when you're diving.
Do they just start with one little polyp and then reproduce?
Yes, so it's all, it's a clonal organism. That each of the polyps in the organism are genetically identical to one another. So it'll start as a little tiny piece, just a centimeter or so high, with perhaps a dozen polyps. And then over a long period of time, they grow enormous. So actually they're very long-lived organisms. The big sea fans, like this one, is probably 100 years or more old. And they're actually protected because they are so old.
And if a piece breaks off, it's essentially the same
I think
organism?
It's pretty much had it. I don't think it is able to attach itself again. But it would go on living. A piece broken off would go on living. So you could break off a piece and put it in your aquarium and it will survive. But I don't think it'll be able to make a new attachment to the rock. So those are sea fans. They have a flexible skeleton. And then the third group are the soft corals. And as the name suggests, they don't have a skeleton at all. So they form little hummocks or mounds of, again, little clonal organisms that are all growing together and all have a shared gut. They can exchange nutrients between one another, but they don't have any skeleton at all. And that is mainly a more tropical group. And if you look in rock pools in KwaZulu-Natal, you'll find some very spectacular species of these. Some of them actually have an interesting habit of pulsing like this, so they're called pulsing soft corals. and the individual polyps are constantly moving like this, and that's to increase oxygen exchange. We only really get one species that's very common down here in the Western Cape, but although we only have one, it is a spectacularly beautiful purple species. And it has an equally spectacular purple nudibranch, which only feeds on it.
I often find the soft corals in the holdfasts at the base of the kelp plants.
Right.
Yes. Where else can you see them?
The soft corals actually usually like protected environments, so you'll often find them on the sides of boulders or in little crevices underneath boulders. In fact, I actually noticed some very nice colonies right underneath this boulder that we're standing on here. In deeper rock pools, if you look at the vertical rock faces, or where there's big boulders like this, if you look in little caves underneath the sides of those boulders, they're actually very common and they occur quite high up in the intertidal.
And the sea fans?
The sea fans are mostly slightly deeper, so you see them when you're snorkeling, or if you turn over boulders in the intertidal here, then you'll often see small colonies underneath the boulders. But there is one species, the multicolored sea fan, which actually has a slightly different body form. Instead of making a flat fan, it kind of makes a big bunch of spaghetti. The skeleton just all intersperses with itself and makes a big mesh, a big nest. And it comes in several different colors. You can get white ones, yellow ones, red ones, and purple ones. And that's why it's called a multicolored sea fan. But that's actually very common right here in the intertidal and in these pools right below us here. But take a look at those colonies closely, because the individual polyps are actually exquisitely beautiful. Each one has just 8 tentacles, which they hold out into the water, trying to grasp food particles. And also, if you see egg strands on the sea fans, or you see damage on the sea fans, take a closer look at that area, because you'll often find a very well camouflaged nudibranch crawling around on the sea fan and feeding on it.